Okay, the Airport Commission meeting of April 24th.
March 24th.
I'm living in the future now. I'm ready to go. This retirement, you don't even know what month it is. Will now come to order. All rise for the Pledge of Allegiance. There's a flag behind the curtain.
We can see it.
We can see it, yeah. You can take it on faith.
Can we just open the curtain?
Oh, yeah, you could. There we go.
Ta-da! Pulling a rabbit out of the hat.
We're on minutes now.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Christine, would you do the roll call, please?
Commissioner Sonio?
Here.
Commissioner Fors?
Here.
Commissioner Johnson?
Present.
Commissioner McGregor?
Here.
Commissioner Purvis?
Here.
Commissioner White? Chairperson Shoemaker?
Present. Now we have two sets of minutes for the approval. And the first one we want to look at is Thursday, January 28th, 2016. There were some modifications to that we need to make sure that we got correct. And I'd like to ask the airport president to confirm that the changes are correct. Satisfactory. Airport business. Present. Lori Atkins?
Yeah.
Fine. Thanks. And if that's the case, then I think that we had no objections last time. Are there any more changes or addendum to the minutes this time? Seeing none, do we have a motion for approval?
I motion to approve.
Second.
Motion by Asonio, second by McGregor. We need a roll call. On this, or can we do this by eyes?
It's all roll call, but you can actually do one approval for the entire consent.
For both of them?
Item,
good. So. Do we have any additions, changes to the minutes for Thursday, February 25th? Seeing none from the commission, none from the audience. If there are no changes, let's have a roll call.
You need a motion.
If you want to modify your motion for both of them, I'll modify my second for both of them.
Okay, I modify my motion to approve the January 28th and the February 25th meeting minutes.
As written.
As written.
And I modify my second.
Second. Christine.
Commissioner Asonio?
Approved.
Commissioner Fors?
Approved.
Commissioner Johnson?
Approved.
Commissioner McGregor?
Approved.
Commissioner Purvis?
Approved.
Commissioner White? Chairperson Shoemaker?
Approved. We have before us the Stephen Brown Associates Airport Ground Lease and Office Space Market Valuation and Appraisal. You want to bring us up to speed on that, Brett?
Yeah, and good evening, Commissioners. Thank you for being here. This is just a continuation of the last several months. The city hired Stephen Brown Associates to conduct a market rent analysis for the airport. And essentially, we asked him to view several parcels, mostly which were vacant land, or some were vacant land and some were ground leases that have improvements on them. And then we also asked him to look at some office space and some other facilities. Stephen Brown went and did comparables. He reached out to many airports. I think there was about 26 airports that he reached out to begin developing a list of comparables. And then he met with if the parcel of land had someone on it that was leasing it, such as Cal Pacific Air Motive or Potts Paint, he met with the lessee, discussed the project site more in depth. He met with city staff, to discuss lease terms, to discuss the site, our view on the future of the airport, existing or extenuating circumstances. And through all of this work, he has developed just a very general set of rates for the airport. And so for basic ground leases, the report has suggested a rental valuation of 30 to 36 cents per square foot annually. And an aviation ground lease rent, such as POTS, which is discounted because of lack of access to infrastructure, which is namely water, sewer, and roads, there's a discounted rate for 20 cents per square foot. He went above and beyond, and he also, through the information that he had gathered from all the airports, he actually provided us a cost per square foot for hangar rentals, which that's somewhere around 32 to 36 cents a square foot. Down at the bottom, I put that we're around 23 cents per square foot annually, and that's our average rate. We have a lot of old hangars that are dilapidated, and we have some newer, nicer hangars. We have hangars that have electric bifold doors, and we have some that are wood doors that you can barely push. So this is a very average rate. And then also an airport office lease rent for like essentially office space between 75 cents and 90 cents a square foot. We've brought this several times to the commission just to kind of keep you up to speed as to the progress of the project. It is complete. We have the final report, which there hasn't been any changes to the draft report. It's just now this is the final version. And we're asking the commission merely to recommend approval of the report as final. Mind you, just because we have these rates doesn't mean that we're going to go and raise all the rates for hangar rents up to 32 cents or 36 cents a square foot. It doesn't mean that if we negotiate a new lease tomorrow that it would fall between 30 and 36 cents a square foot for land. It is merely a starting point for us to begin discussions. And if the rate that is proposed by the lessee is off, then we have some background to ask questions as to, well, why do you believe that the lease rate should be lower, higher, et cetera. So it's merely a starting point for negotiation. So with that is the summary of the report. And again, the recommendation that staff is recommending is in the report, just asking to recommend the report as final.
Commissioner Purvis, you have a question?
Yes, I was curious as to why you picked the buildings or the ground leases that you did as the base. And is that the base for all the ground leases?
Well, the reason some of these parcels were chosen, they were a pretty fair representation of the airport, whether they were close to infrastructure, if they had improvements built on them. And moreover, for example, we'll talk about Cal Pacific Aeromotive. In their lease, it has a provision that every 5 years that we're supposed to do a rental escalation, or at least propose a rental escalation. We're going to review it.
Better.
And you need some basis to start with. It doesn't really have it. We don't do it by CPI. We're supposed to come up with a rate. They provide a rate. We provide a rate and meet hopefully somewhere in the middle. Gomes Air Services, they've essentially gone out of business. And they're looking to sell the building. And when they sell the building, we're going to have to drop a new lease for whoever comes in. This gives us a starting point to bring the base rate up to what would be fair and reasonable for that lease. A few other ones, such as office space. We use office space because we know that upstairs above the second story in the terminal, we need to lease that out. We believe CalSTAR wants to move in there, and once they move out, that will create vacancies over in 240. So we needed an office rate. Instead of me going out and doing these surveys, we decided to hire a professional that is better vetted than myself determining rates. So,
Commissioner McGregor?
How was that average determined? And what is that, just a mathematical average of all of those? Is it a weighted average, or how? Where did that come from?
Are you talking about the current 23 cents per square foot?
Yes.
And so we know this is for all of our hangars. We can create a base rate or a cost per square foot, and then we average those out amongst all of the facilities. So I believe our lowest facility is somewhere around 19 cents, and it goes all the way up to 30 cents. So I took those rates and then averaged them out, and that's about the middle, about 20
Okay, it's not
cents.
A weighted average, it's just a straight average. Okay.
Straight average.
Understanding that this is just a starting point, it looks like they're using a lot of comparisons with Monterey and Watsonville that are different situations, and these look like they might be a little high compared to...
Well, they also went down as far as Paso Robles and had had good success there receiving information. They also tried looking at the various properties at the various airports to create more of a weighted average or a weighted rate. I believe it's pretty fair. It's from the report, if you had the opportunity to read through it, there's just a lot of background as to how they discounted the rates and came up. So
I saw they were very thorough on how they went about the evaluation. I was wondering, I don't know what the current rates are. I've never seen are those substantially above, or are they near what the current rates are?
For
like the ground lease or the aviation ground lease?
They're relatively close to that. I believe we have some that are, and I'm just speaking from memory, I believe Advanced Tech is somewhere around 33 cents a square foot, same with DiRigo and Pacific International. Swiss Express, I think they're right around 33 cents a square foot.
So we're already right about in this range.
I cannot remember ours. I think you were somewhere like 24, 26. Right around there somewhere.
Okay.
So it's within the ballpark. And it's pretty good. It's a good place, again, to start the discussions.
Yeah, it looks like they did a fine and complete job on that. Do we have any recommendations from the board for pass motion? Well, what we want to do on this, the commission may choose to accept the staff's recommendation, which is to accept the report.
I would move we accept the report.
Second.
Moved by McGregor and second by Purvis to accept the report as produced. Christine, would you do a roll call?
Any comment? Public comment? No. Any public comment?
Do we have any public comment on this?
Our public?
I wasn't really going to, but since you mentioned it, another reason I think why Brett did this is there's a few leases on the airport that are based on land value rather than the CPI, and our lease is one of them that's based on land value. So you would have to literally go and get the appraisals and then make proposals. And if we didn't like it, we'd get one. And if they didn't like it, they'd get one. So it's just a common ground.
Okay, thank you. Okay, thanks for clearing that up, Lori. Christine?
Commissioner Sonio?
Approved.
Commissioner Forbes?
Approved.
Commissioner Johnson?
Approved.
Commissioner McGregor?
Aye.
Commissioner Purvis?
Approved.
Commissioner White? Chairperson Shoemaker?
Approved. We have the next order of business is airport rates and fee adjustments. Proposed new meeting time. I checked that off early, didn't I? Thank you. But before that, we have snuck in here a little piece of business that has to do with a proposed new meeting time for Airport Commission meetings. We would do an amendment to the Airport Commission bylaws. So we'll need to discuss what meeting time we would like to have. And there may be some other changes in the bylaws that would be appropriate to change at this time. noticing that they mentioned that they should be reviewed every year, it would probably be a good time to consider it all while we're looking at it. So even if we don't decide on it tonight, I see a couple of things that are slightly out of order that could be rearranged so that we're all within the letter. The order of business is slightly different in the bylaws than it is that we run through, and we could correct that. That's the only little glitch I saw there. But it's been proposed that we change our meeting time to an earlier time, and I'd like to know if there's any comment from the board. Commissioner McGregor.
Yeah, I personally like the number one is to go to 5:30, but I don't know how that works with the poor working stiff still here on the commission. So that, but no, I think that kind of...
Not me.
Oh, okay, there's
so
one.
If it...
Okay, there's one of me.
Yeah, but...
Well, I occasionally try my hand at working once in a while, and 5:30 is a little early.
If the early time works for people, well, I would favor that. If not, the 6 o'clock is certainly an improvement. I think moves it up a little bit, for sure.
Are we talking in terms of the same day? We're just changing the time.
Correct.
Thank you.
Yeah, 5:30 works for me.
Okay, I like 6 o'clock. And everybody else is fine with 5:30?
I'm actually
I can do it either. I'll make either work.
You what?
I can make either work.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
I prefer 6 o'clock, but majority would rule.
Okay. I'm good with either.
Good with either.
I can go either way.
Okay.
Yeah.
6 o'clock?
If 6 o'clock is going to cause a hardship for any, or I mean 5:30 is going to cause a hardship for any one person, then I think we should go for the 6. That's my personal feeling.
I'm not sure that 5:30 would be as much a hardship as my experience with meetings starting at the half hour, people always think, oh, it's 6 o'clock or it's 5 o'clock. And that would be my reason for going for 6 o'clock.
I'm also thinking in terms of traffic. You know, trying to get to the meeting by 5:30 when that's when all the traffic is moving.
So that's a thought. Yeah,
that's a good point, because it adds 15 minutes just going from one side of town to the other at that time.
I make a motion that we change the meeting time, the Airport Commission meeting time, from the current 7 p.m. to 6 p.m., keeping it the fourth Thursday of the month.
And I second.
Can we vote on that tonight, or does that have to go on the agenda for a change?
It'll need to go on the agenda for change next month. And I'm going to work with the city clerk and see if it's possible just to pull the time out. And there's certain language that we can set in the bylaws that says that the meetings will be set by the commission and then posted. So that way you don't have to go back and change the bylaws every time you change the meeting time.
Excellent idea.
What we will do is when we bring this back to the commission next month, because that's what the bylaws say we need to do, we will have alternatives and language to put in, to insert into the bylaws. Okay. And we'll make those part of the alternatives for you to vote on.
Great.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded, and now we're in discussion. But so, Commissioner Sonio?
Brett, it is on the agenda.
The bylaws state that if you make a change, it needs to come back the following month.
It has to be on two meetings.
Yeah, it has to come back for approval on the second month. Okay. So,
yeah.
I have one last question. What is the reasoning why it's being changed?
It's just in passing, a few of the commissioners said that they might enjoy or prefer an earlier time, and so taking that into account, we decided to put on the agenda and see if this is the direction that the commission wanted to go. So it can stay at 7 o'clock if you so choose. You don't have to move it, but just a few people have said that it'd be nice if it was earlier.
Commissioner Sonio.
You all have to come to these meetings. Lori drives down to South County. Earl, I mean, what time do you guys prefer?
Earlier the better for me. Mm-hmm. I think everyone wants to get back to their family.
Okay.
So.
Commissioner Purvis.
Okay. You had mentioned that there are other things in here that might be up for change at the same time.
Yep.
There's a section in here under the meetings where if we have a cancellation, you're supposed to post it on a bulletin board. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of very old school.
We're still required to do that.
Yeah.
Brown Act.
Brown Act.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sorry. Mm-hmm. That's what this board out here is literally for, so we can post it. It's for people that might not have internet access, and so they know where the meetings will be posted if there's changes to them. So,
or if you get here a couple minutes late and the meeting's been changed from here to there, you've got a board you can look at. I've used it once, so I found it quite useful. We were meeting back in the West Wing, I think they call it. Section 5 of the bylaws has order of business, roll call, approval of minutes, airport manager's report, commission considerations. We do things in a slightly different order, and we've been doing it this way ever since I've been attending. I think that we could adjust that to reflect the way that we do order of business.
We can make those proposed changes and put that into the staff report and bylaws for next month.
Okay, it's. Do we need an approval, a motion and an approval on that, I would imagine?
You can make a motion and approval to make changes to reflect the current order of meetings or.
Yeah.
Current order of business at a regular meeting. Businesses will be conducted in the following order. So what we can do is we can take our agendas that we have and then change the bylaws to reflect that. So,
okay. Commissioner Flores, did you make that motion?
I'll make that motion, what you said.
So the motion is to I can't make the motion, but what I was saying is
I can paraphrase. I can phrase the motion. Section 5 order of business will be reordered to reflect the current order of business as it's been conducted by the Airport Commission. Moved in by Commissioner Forrest, seconded by McGregor. Any public comment? Christine, would you do a roll call vote?
Commissioner Sonio?
Approved.
Commissioner Forrest?
Approved.
Commissioner Johnson?
Approved.
Commissioner McGregor?
Approved.
Commissioner Purvis?
Approved.
Commissioner White? Chairperson Shoemaker?
Approved.
Commissioner Sonia, did you want to bring that up?
Yeah, then since we're going through this, in Section 7, it says manner of voting. Voting on matters coming before the commission will be by voice vote unless there is a division of opinion, in which case the voting will be by roll call and the yeas and nays will be entered into the minutes. We've eliminated the voice vote. As far as I can tell, it seems like now everything is done via roll call. So that language should probably be cleaned up in Section 7.
Okay.
Yeah, I think council recommended that everything be done by voice vote.
Okay.
So
this one, I will talk to the city attorney and city clerk and see if there's a recommended form for how they establish the voting
language. Yeah, it could just say voting on matters coming before the commission will be by roll call and the yeas and nays. You could take out that entire second line.
Okay.
Of that paragraph or that section.
Yeah, it's shaped by roll call and recorded as such or something. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I didn't see anything
else. Are there any other changes, additions, deletions to the minutes anybody would like to propose? Seeing none, let's go on to further business and get back to airport rates and fees adjustments.
All right, so Our fiscal year for the airport and for the city runs from July to June. And so the working backwards in June, we expect the proposed 2016-2017 budget to go in front of City Council. So we need to make sure that we're out in front of that, and any amendments that are any proposals that the commission wishes to address, that we make sure that we get in front of you, so that way you can make comments or recommendations well before I'm writing the report for the City Council meeting. This meeting alone is just to introduce the idea. We typically, as staff, I've historically brought items over many months to the commission, so it's not just I bring it in front of you and expect you to vote on it one time and then move on to the next thing. We're going to work through ideas and give you time to think about it and provide comments on it. So typically, the items that I bring before the commission is revenue expenses and capital projects. And those items will come before the commission at the next meeting. I will provide an in-depth analysis and proposal of the revenue expenses and the proposed capital projects for next year. And then with that, we should have plenty of time to comment and make recommendations for June. Historically, since I've been here, the last two budgets that we've worked through, pretty much we've just gone and made CPI adjustments, the consumer price index adjustments to the hangar rents. And most of the other fees, miscellaneous fees we'll call them, we haven't touched, and I don't believe that they've been touched in 5, 7, sometimes 8 years, maybe longer. And so it's time to look at some of those fees to see if it's worth updating those and adjusting them. And then one of the other things that this year we're going to focus on is what is called a non-aeronautical hangar fee surcharge policy. It's all one thing wrapped together. And in discussing, let me see what my next slide is. Okay. In discussing this, what I wanted to convey to the commission is that being that we're an airport, and being that we accept grants from the federal government to do capital improvements, the year before last, we accepted $3.2 million from the federal government. This last year, we accepted $150, and this year, we're going to accept somewhere around $240. And depending if the FAA has additional monies, all the way up to $900,000 from the FAA. What needs to be understood is that there are strings attached with those grants that the FAA provides us. And those strings are in the form of what we call assurances. And the FAA wants to ensure that if they're giving us money, that the airport will be available for aviation uses in the future. And pretty much all of those assurances, there's 39 of them, they're all surrounded of making sure that the airport is viable, that it's there, it's part, that the federal government can depend on the airport being part of the national air system. One of the things that they stipulate is that aeronautical uses need to happen at an airport. And by aeronautical uses, it could be a business that's aviation-oriented. It could be if you own an aircraft, you can store it there, et cetera. There's all sorts of ways to be aviation-oriented. The majority of airports in the United States were built to what we call 1990 capacity. In the 90s, aviation was booming. There were many, many airplanes. If you look back at old aerial pictures of airports, you'll see that a lot of the transient ramps were full with aircraft. You look at pictures nowadays, and not many airports have a lot of aircraft on the ramps. The pilot population is dwindling. Aircraft aren't being replaced as fast as they're going out. Aviation is getting more expensive. Knowing that, before knowing that, the FAA has had a very strict stance on what's allowed to be used in a hangar. Pretty much, the FAA wants to see an aircraft in a hangar, and that's it. Maybe a few other things that support the aircraft, such as if you have cabinets to store fluids, such as oil, or to clean your aircraft, or pilot supplies, or a desk to do flight planning. That was traditionally what the FAA has wanted to have happen in the hangars. The aircraft hangars, if you were to compare the cost per square foot, is severely below what you would see traditionally outside the fence. For example, average cost per square foot annually is somewhere around $3.30 at our airport. Outside the fence, if you rent a storage space, average cost is around $13.30. And so for storing, just typical storage, there is a big difference in what we charge for people to store their aircraft in hangars versus what you could rent a storage place off the airport. And that's partly in reason because the use of the hangar is supposed to be limited. It's aviation. You're not supposed to go and store RVs in the hangars. You're not supposed to put all of your extra home goods into the hangar. It's supposed to be aviation. And so the rate that is applied to the user or levied on the user is reflective of the anticipated use and the value of what you could do with that. Knowing that airports were developed to 1990 capacities and aircraft ownership and new pilots in the market has been on the downward trend since the 90s, the FAA has taken a very slow response to realize that if they want to keep airports operating as airports, airports need to be more creative as to how we generate funds to keep the airports open. It's very expensive to rehabilitate a new runway, even if you're matching at 10%. If it costs $1 million to repave a runway and you're matching at 10%, the sponsor is expected to pay $100,000 to repave that runway. And a lot of airports don't generate that type of revenue regularly to even provide matching funds for grants. So much so that grants that are provided are provided to the sponsor are returned back to the FAA because they can't even generate the matching funds. This is happening more and more and more and more. So the FAA itself is working on developing a new policy, which can come out anywhere within a year, 2 years. We don't exactly know when it's coming, but the FAA is working on it. A new revised policy that will say what the FAA believes is appropriate use of an airport hangar. In the interim, and for the last 2 years, I know, the FAA on a case-by-case basis has been approving non-aeronautical use in the hangars. And this is in the report that I've provided to the commission. This is one of the biggest sections that I've written. It's more or less a non-aeronautical hangar use policy that discusses the policy in depth as to what the pros, cons, and the procedures of it would be. The policy, in essence, would allow the city of Salinas, the airport, to lease out hangars or rent out hangars on short-term basis for non-aeronautical purposes in the event we had surplus hangars. Keep in mind the policy as written, and even the policy that the FAA will develop here within the next year, the primary priority of the policy will be aviation. If there's an aviation use identified, aviation use has to take precedence. And that's the way this policy is written. So I'll work through this policy that I'm proposing here. In the event we have surplus hangars, we'd be permitted to, if we had surplus hangars and we did not have anyone on the waiting list, if we could not identify an aeronautical use, the city of Salinas would be permitted to lease out facilities on a short-term basis, same as we do the regular hangars, a month-to-month basis, to non-aeronautical uses. But because it's non-aeronautical, the FAA mandates that if it's non-aeronautical, it has to be a fair market value. The rates that we charge at $350 are fair and reasonable. That's what the aviation market will provide. Fair market value is what your local economy will provide, so the rates should be much closer to the $13.30 a square foot, somewhere around that range. In the event an aeronautical use is identified, someone walks into our office door and says, I have an airplane, I would like to house it at your airport. All of the non-aeronautical hangars are in inventory for the aeronautical use to choose which hangar they'd like to lease out. So that way the aeronautical use takes precedence, has priority because we're an airport. Stipulated in the agreement that we developed, typically it could be anywhere from 10 to 30 days. After the aeronautical use identifies a hangar that they wish to lease out, the non-aeronautical use has to move out within the given time that we stipulate in the lease. So the FAA will identify case-by-case basis. Our case-by-case basis would be the process would be to submit a lease or an application to permit that we use, the non-aeronautical permit, to the FAA compliance office and let them review it. Provided that they're okay with the agreement that we provide to them, we could then begin implementing the non-aeronautical use. So the justification for this is that city staff, over the last few months, we've had to enter hangars to do several different projects. One of those projects was the electrical upgrade project where we switched out lights to LED lighting and we went into every single hangar. And then also within the last month, our last 2-3 months, we had to do our annual fire suppression inspection. So pretty much all the hangars on the south side have fire suppression in them. And so we had to enter in those hangars again. We took note of the non-aeronautical uses that were happening on the airport. And in the last 3 years, there have been no hangars rented out to non-aeronautical uses. What has happened is pilots or hangar lessees or pilots who owned aircraft, from time to time, they sell their aircraft and then they don't replace it. Well, instead of letting city staff know that they've sold their aircraft, they just go ahead and maintain the hangar and then they move RVs and storage in there and then it becomes a non-aeronautical use. In our inspection, we have determined that there is just under 30 hangars on the airport that are being used for non-aeronautical uses. And there are still approximately 10 hangars, Earl, that we haven't been able to get into. There's about 10 hangars that we haven't been able to get into because the tenant has changed their lock, and so we don't have a key to it. So we're sending notice to those tenants to advise them that they need to provide us a key, city staff a key, or we will cut the lock and then put a city lock on there and then provide them a key. It's actually in their hangar rental agreement that they're to provide us a key if they change out the lock. So we still have about 10 more hangars to go through. Currently, right now, we have 4 people on the waiting list. And so if we removed all the non-aeronautical uses, we would have somewhere around 26 to 22 hangars that would be empty. And that equates to about 10% of our annual revenue for our hangar storage fees. And our hangar storage fees equates to about $600,000 a year. So 10% would be $60,000 a year if we booted, approximately, if we evicted those tenants for non-aeronautical uses. So in lieu of evicting the tenants for non-aeronautical uses, the proposal is to move forward with a non-aeronautical policy that would allow us to then rent the hangars out, apply a surcharge for a fair market value to those hangars, and then once we have those tenants on the new non-aeronautical agreement, the people that are on the waiting list, the four people that are on the waiting list would then have choice over which hangars that they would like to move into. So that is before we move on to the other items, that is the non-aeronautical policy in a nutshell, a walnut shell. And if there's any questions, I'd like to hear them.
Commissioner Sonia.
Commissioner Sonio.
assuming we have a surplus of empty hangars and we want to rent it out to a non-aeronautical use, does every single one of those rental agreements need to go back to the FAA for approval, or do a blanket policy?
I will send the master agreement. I will not send them the policy. The FAA will not approve a policy. They will approve your agreement, and they have recommended that they want to see those policies in the agreement. It's kind of an interesting way, because if the FAA approves our policy, then a year from now they create a policy that's different. They have it doesn't look good upon them. So what they recommended doing is sending the rental agreement, which they can make comments all day long on rental agreements, whether they would approve it or not. It's a backdoor way of approving our policy, because our policy is going to be.
But you would have to do that for every single
hangar. Just a master agreement.
Oh, just once.
One master agreement. Okay. If they approve the master agreement and we use that for every non-aeronautical hangar use, then that would suffice.
Commissioner McGregor?
I would assume if somebody out there that had a hangar for an aeronautical use and sold their airplane and opted to take it for non-aeronautical, then the rent triples. If they got an airplane again, it would go back down?
Yes. Not an issue doing that. If they're an aeronautical use, what we want to do is we want to make sure that we're, even though it appears that we're opening the door for non-aeronautical use, that's not what we're doing. The primary use of an airport is for aircraft, and the airport benefits from having flying aircraft. Our fuel concessions go up, which helps not only the city with a fuel flowage fee, it helps Jet West because they're keeping them employed. If we have flyable aircraft, it's keeping the businesses employed and keeping workers busy by conducting annuals and maintenance. And just the downstream effect of, which is why we exist. I mean, the primary use and what we would prefer is not even to have a non-aeronautical policy and have our hangars full of aircraft, but that does not exist. It's just, I wish it was the other way around, but that's not the reality.
Commissioner Purvis.
And I have a question about an aeronautical use renter who sees one of those other hangars that is being used for non-aeronautical use, and they would rather be in that one than in the one they're in. How would we handle that?
So say again, phrase that again. Let me just make sure I understand you.
Okay. Somebody who has an airplane in their hangar sees a hangar that they like a lot better, and it's no airplane in it.
Mm-hmm. Aeronautical takes preference.
So they would be able to claim that hangar?
Yes.
You might want to explain the groups, so we have group one, group two, group
three. That's okay. No, that's fine. If they wanted to switch to a different hangar and they're aeronautical takes precedence. So we do not give any favoritism to non-aeronautical uses.
Commissioner Forrest.
What is the time limit that renter would have to move out of that space?
For the non-aeronautical use?
Yes.
Is what you're saying? It'll be stipulated in the lease agreement. I'll talk with the city attorney. It can be anywhere from 10 days to 30 days. Is typically what we would provide, just standard notice to move out. So, but again, the agreement, the process will be, I have a draft, take that to the city attorney, allow him to review it, make sure that meets city policy, city standard, and then it goes to FAA compliance for them to review and make sure that it meets their compliance. And so.
Commissioner Johnson.
Brett, do the non-aeronautical hangar folks know that this policy is effective, or are they going to be?
No, this is actually pretty very brand new. This is something that we started working on just this last month. Notices will go out, and the rates won't change until July, August sometime, so there will be lots of notice for them. And in order for them to stay, they will have to come in and develop a new rental agreement with us, which would be a non-aeronautical agreement. So it's going to be a lot of coordination, it's a lot of work, but it's what needs to be done in order to make sure that we're compliant on our end, ensuring that either we have aviation uses and they're being charged a fair value, or we have non-aeronautical and we have an agreement that says that with a policy, and on top of that, that they're being charged fair market value. That is what the FAA mandates. So you either have it or you don't. If you don't have it, you got to get them out. If you do have it, it's fair market value for non-aeronautical is what I'm talking about.
Do you know about when you're going to be notifying them?
It won't be before next month because, again, the policy would need to be recommended by the commission that this is the policy. This is the rental agreement. We'd be developing a new rental agreement. So that needs to go through the body, which hoping next month or the following month. And then I believe a new rental agreement would need to go through city council. I need to confirm with the city attorney. And then there's a certain amount of time that you need to provide notice before the rent goes up. I think for the city of Salinas, it's about 30 days notice that we provide, so.
I'd like to comment, it's been a while since I've read the rental agreements, but the rental agreements are on a month-to-month basis.
That's correct.
And I tried to get a longer rental agreement and found it wasn't possible. So, and everybody knows that the rental agreement does say that it's for an aircraft.
Yeah.
And so, if I can remember back that long, I believe that all hangar renters understand this already. Everybody's just waiting for the other shoe to drop about when is the enforcement going to take place.
If I was renting the hangar, I would probably, and I was non-aeronautical, I would probably say it was a good ride. So,
mm-hmm. Yes, it's been a good ride. That's a good way to look at it. Any other questions from the commissioners?
And this is just the questions is just on the non-aeronautical policy. There was a few other things that I wanted to discuss also.
Okay, so then you want to go ahead and finish your presentation.
One of the things that haven't been changed in a while is the fuel flowage fee. So for every gallon of fuel that is sold on the airport, the city collects a surcharge, a fee on top of that. And it's been at 8 cents a gallon, I believe for 6, 7, 8 years, maybe even longer than that. I did a survey of airports and found that about 6, 7, 8 airports up north, down south, all over the place, and the average fee was somewhere around 12 cents a gallon for the fuel flowage fees. And what I'm going to be moving forward next month in the proposal is adjusting the 100 low lead fuel flowage fee up to 10 cents and then 15 cents for the Jet A fee. So there's a difference in the fees, and because the Jet A aircraft that take Jet A typically take up more space, they have a higher bearing on our runway system. Overall, it's just a much more intense operation accepting the aircraft. And on top of that, the majority of people or companies buying fuel is for a commercial purpose. So there's some sort of, either it's a business aircraft or it's a charter aircraft. So I think it's appropriate for the airport to charge a slightly higher fee for Jet A fees. That fee alone, if it was in place last year, adjusting it from 8 cents to 15 cents would have brought in an additional $35,000 to the Airport Enterprise Fund. When we talk about adjusting, this is to kind of put things in perspective. When we talk about adjusting the hangar rents on all of our hangars, and that's about 240 hangars, and if we do a CPI every year, around 2.5% or 2.4%, that results in somewhere anywhere between $15,000 to $19,000 additional to the airport enterprise fund. And then we have 240 people that don't like you the next day as soon as you implement that fee. Versus doing a fuel flowage fee, and we charge fuel flowage fees. It's in lieu of a landing fee. That's why general aviation airports and other airports charge a fuel flowage fee. In lieu of a landing fee, saying you landed our airport, that was a there's a cost for you coming in here, we just apply a fuel flowage fee. So I think it's a lot easier to, well, not easier, but I mean, it needs to be done because it hasn't done in a while, but it's a bit more accepting to finally catch up on this rate versus going after the hangar rates this year. A few of the other fees, there's some policies that we wanted to fix. Our gate card access fee, we have a gate card access fee. For $25, you can get a card, and then for $50, you can get a remote. And it's essentially a deposit. So we allow the person to come in and essentially rent the card from us and then turn it back to us after 5 years of use, and then we give them their deposit back. I look at this more as a cost center, that there's time and effort from city staff to do the application fee, to update the database, to insert them in the database, to review the database on an annual basis, all this stuff that we do. And at the end of the day, we give back a deposit, and then we have a card that we can't do anything with. So the proposal is just to remove the deposit. We're gonna take the $25 for the card and $50 for the remote, and then that is a cost center. There's a cost for us to do that business. So that will be a proposal at next month's meeting. Also, adjusting the overnights.
Questions later.
Also adjusting the overnight tie-down fees for a single engine from $3 to $5, a single engine from $5 to $10, and then a jet from $25 to $50. And mind you, when you go to a business or a jet and say we need $50 for a tie-down fee, they still kind of they still kind of laugh at you for charging a whopping $50 for them to bring their aircraft onto your airport. And then also, we're going to adjust our airship mooring fee from $50 to $100 a night. The other one that we plan on adjusting is the policy for the hangar waitlist. Our hangar waitlist causes us more problems than it should, because, again, it's a deposit that we accept for the hangar waitlist, and then we apply that to their first month's rent. If we have people that have been on our hangar wait list now for 4 years, 5 years. How long has Alcross been on our hangar wait list?
I think it's more like 8 years.
8 years. So 8 years he's been on, he wants one hangar, and every year he has to pay the $50 to get back on the hangar waiting list. And then at a time when he actually takes a hangar, we have to go back and track in the records when he paid that $50. And then apply that to his first month's rent whenever he decides to take a hangar. So instead of doing that, it'll be $50 to get on the hangar wait list. It's a one-time fee. You don't have to pay the fee annually. And again, it's a cost center. There's a cost for us doing the paperwork. And then every month when a new person gets on the wait list, we update the list that's online that you can do. So again, $50 is just the cost. It's more of a cost for just doing the transaction. No longer will that $50 be applied to your first month's rent, so staff doesn't have to go in and prorate $50 off. And then if you came in the middle of the month, we still have to prorate it if you were in the hangar for 17 days out of the 30 day. No, we're gonna simplify the process. $50 get on, and that's the wait list. And then when we propose these the rates and fees at the next month's meeting or the following month's meeting. Special events, instead of setting a special event fee, the special event fee will be negotiated. Special events fees vary immensely from people coming in. Sometimes they want access to a ramp. Sometimes they want access to a building. Sometimes they want to have the runway or a taxiway. And so staff will work on negotiating a rate that is fair based off of the resource that they're using and the time that they're using, more cost recovery than us just charging a one-time fee. So we'll have staff recovery costs in it. So if they need a maintenance worker or an operations personnel to be with them for the event, then we can apply those charges to it. Those are the fees as is that are being recommended. That doesn't mean that the commission can't recommend additional fees for the staff to look at and present next month. This year as is, if we are able to do the non-aeronautical policy and the fuel flowage fees, I'm just rough estimates, it's somewhere between $40,000 to $60,000 additional coming into the airport enterprise fund. And you will notice that I have not mentioned anything about the hangars this year and doing a CPI adjustment. I think that we've done this for 8 years. I think we're going on 8 years strong, and unless the commission recommends that that's what they want to see, it wasn't going to be on the proposal.
Thanks, Brett. I'm going to jump in and comment here. I'm glad to see that you're going to changing the deposit on the hangar, because that just never made sense to me to have to be paying to be on the list every year and then not getting any benefit from it. One person could be on the list for a month and another for years, and I think it's a much more equitable way to do it. But I know Commissioner Osonio had a question.
Yeah, regarding the deposits and some of these fees, specifically the gate access card and the remote control and the waiting list deposit, how are you going to implement these? So, like, for example, the gentleman that's been on the waiting list for 8 years, are you going to refund him the money? Are you going to grandfather him in? And so he doesn't have to pay for the next 8 years? Well, hopefully he won't be on the list that much longer, but, you know, you've got people who have paid.
Yeah.
So what are you going to do with them? I understand the policy going forward, but how are you going to grandfather these people in?
So for the gate cards, it's just pretty straightforward. It'll be the policy. It is as is. We don't need any more cards back or remotes. It'll just be applied as a fee that was assessed. And we'll work with the finance department to get that straightened out. We'll send notices out to the tenants, letting them know that we're not gonna be accepting the gate cards back anymore. We have boxes and boxes of old cards, and it costs more for us to do that than it is just to turn it off. So case by case basis, I don't know. We can work with the people on the hangar wait list. I don't mind the people that have already on the wait list that we've said that this is a deposit and it'll go towards your first month's rent. I'm more than fine working with them. Again, there's only four people on the wait list anyways. But moving forward, our new hangar wait list application would just say that it is a fee. So.
But go ahead.
Okay, so then going back to the cards, so you got these boxes of cards that people have turned back in. Can't they be reprogrammed and or recycled at a recycling facility? Because and hotels, they give you the key cards, and they're all recycled.
Ours are much more expensive than those cards. And by recycle, you mean reuse them and issue them out again? Is that something else?
Either that or don't store them in the closet. I mean, can you take them to
we keep them. We've kept at least a box of them, so that way if there's a construction project or something and we need temporary cards for the construction project, but most of them we just break up and throw away. And most of them, you know, if someone had it for 3 years and they keep it in their wallet, it's
shot.
Okay.
You don't want my old card.
It looks like a banana. So
Commissioner Purvis.
Okay, I have two questions here. First, about those key cards, you can deprogram them, though, right?
Yes, yes, okay, that's not a problem.
Right, when somebody is going to keep their card, we don't want them back into the facility.
No. So the way that it works is if a tenant moves away, we would just deprogram it. Okay. So.
And on the hangar wait list, you're charging somebody to get on the wait list, but what happens with somebody who just happens to come in at a time when there isn't a wait list and can just get right in, and he wouldn't have to pay the fee?
Nope.
So it's only the people who get stuck with having to be on the wait list.
Yep.
It just doesn't seem quite fair.
It's just how wait lists work. It's really, I mean, it's a tracking device, so we can reach out to you and say, hey, a hanger's available, so.
Okay, Commissioner Johnson.
On that wait list fee, the people that have been waiting for 8 years, are they waiting for a special hanger?
This is one person that's been waiting for one hanger, and as soon as that person moves out of the hanger, he's going to go into it.
Is it one of the non-aeronautical uses?
No. That's Romeo 1 that he wants, correct?
He wants Romeo 3.
He wants a specific, Romeo 3 is one of our executive hangers on the south side with bifold doors. He wants that specific one, and whenever the people go, he wants to move into it. Mm-hmm. So
he's not complaining about the fee per month on the waiting list?
Fee per year? I don't know if he's ever complained about the fee per year. It just kind of accepted it. But now it'll just be, he won't have to pay again. So that makes it a lot easier. So
I have one more question. On the tie-down fee, if the pilot buys fuel, is there a way of waiving that tie-down fee if he buys fuel at our airport?
You know, there, Jet West, the way that he works it, if you park over on his ramp and you buy a certain amount of fuel, he'll waive the ramp fee for staying on his ramp. We've never had that fee. We've never had that policy. It's something that we could look at. It's more of a tracking issue, because we'll send out a notice saying if the pilot didn't pay before he left, we'll take his tail number, and then we'll send a notice to him and say, hey, by the way, you need to pay us unless you send us a receipt. And it's just, you wind up going back and forth because we don't control the fuel vendor. I know at airports that I had been at where we did fueling, we waived those fees because we were in control. We knew if someone pumped gas or not, where we'd have to go and track down Jet West and see if they did.
If I could comment on that, the tie-down fee is an overnight fee, and it's separate. It's not like a landing fee. A landing fee is often waived if you buy fuel at the FBO at airports, but it's not customary to do the overnight fee.
Well, it's the same. That's same thing. Same premise that some airports do, and typically it's if the airport sells their own fuel, they'll waive the overnight transient fee. Sometimes they'll waive one night if they stay multiple nights. Sometimes they'll waive multiple, but for us, because we don't control the fuel, it's just more of,
can't track it.
It's more work than it's worth. So.
Commissioner McGregor.
In my experience flying around the country, you had three different fees. You had a landing fee, you had a ramp fee, and you had an overnight fee. The ramp fee would be waived if you bought so much fuel. Never was the landing fee waived, because that was paid to the airport authority, whatever it was, and the tie down or the overnight very often is the same way. And I know when I had Air Trails, I had to pay the city the overnight fee for anybody that stayed on my ramp overnight. If I charged other fees, it was up to me to waive those if I wanted to.
Yeah.
So it depends on who is generating the fee. So
Ryan has the ability to charge overnight fees for his tie downs and a ramp fee for his tie downs. And then the fuel flowage fee, which is our landing fee, is never waived. So
yeah.
Same thing.
Okay, do we have any more questions from the board on the wait list? The hangar wait list, the deposits, fuel flowage fees, seeing none. Anything from the public?
I think it might be clear to point out that you're not looking to put a little small airplane in an executive hangar. The person who's waiting for the executive hangar also has a large aircraft that will only fit in the executive hangar.
For Alcross?
Yeah.
Earl, go on up there and talk about Mr. Cross.
Thank you.
He's going to speak specifically about the one case of a person being on the wait list for 8 years.
So this person is waiting for an executive hangar because he has a large enough aircraft that will only fit in an executive hangar. So that's why he's waiting for a specific one. We only have 5 of those on the field. So his only choice is to wait for one of those to open up so his aircraft can actually fit inside of there. It's not that he's looking to put in something small that could go into a different use hangar versus the one that he's actually waiting for. So I just wanted to make sure that was clarified. That's why he's been on the list for so long. Those just don't turn over on a high rate.
Okay. Thank you.
Commissioner Johnson?
Earl? Where is he parking his airplane now?
I think one is on the field and one is off the field. He has 2 of them.
Yeah. Oh, interesting. Okay.
Okay, this does not require any action from the board at this time. This is informational so that we know what's going to be coming to us next month. And the next item of business is a report by Brett on the Mortensen Avenue restroom upgrade.
I don't have, that's fine. Just an update. We haven't talked about this project in a while. 240 Mortensen is a building that is adjacent to the airport terminal. And we've proposed doing upgrades to the bathroom facilities and making them ADA compliant. You haven't heard much about it because it went out for bid about a month or 2 months ago, and the bids came in about 180% over what it is the engineer's estimate was. I think the engineer's estimate was somewhere around 103, and it came in well over $214,000 or somewhere close. And so we denied the one bid, and then we put it back out onto the street and bid again. It was a consensus. This was conveyed to me from our engineering department, who actually puts the project out to bid, that there were several other projects being bidded at the same time, and this was just a small fry compared to the rest of the projects. So we put the project back out to bid again, and we actually had 2 people bid on it, and both of those came in well below the first bid. And it's around $150,000 is what the project is going to be built for. Again, that's significantly over engineer's estimate, around 103, but we decided to move forward with it anyways to get the bathrooms upgraded because they're just so bad over there in that building. The new bathrooms will have 2 separate bathrooms, a male, a female, and a break area in there. And so the contractor that won the bid was American Construction Engineers out of Toll House, California. On April 5th, the item will go back to City Council for a notice of award. And then from that point, the contracts need to be signed, and that can take anywhere from 2 to 4 weeks. So we anticipate sometime in May having a pre-construction meeting and then work to start after that, probably most likely in June. The project itself is 50 working days, and there is some lead and asbestos that needs to be mitigated as part of this project. So,
Commissioner Sonio, you have a question?
Yeah, actually 2. Which building is this one?
It's 240 Mortensen. It's, if you know where Sean Tucker's is located, or R&B, so if you're facing the terminal, it's the building off to the left.
We have pictures.
I don't think that there's. Maybe in
west in the terminal, basically.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So if it's to the left. If let me see if I have a picture. Say again.
It runs parallel to the.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Okay. Then the second question is, where was that contractor? Who's the apparent low? Where are they located from?
Toll House, California.
Toll House, like cookies?
Yeah.
Yeah, the other side of Fresno.
Yeah, it's east of Fresno, up in the hills. That's just where their business address is.
Would it be possible, that we adopt a local preference policy?
The city has a local preference policy.
Fresno or where is not local. I mean,
well, what the local preference policy adds additional points to the criteria when you're evaluating them. So
you said you received two bids. Who was the other bid?
I don't remember who the other bid was. I could find out and let you know.
Do you know, off chance, do they know if they were a little bit closer to the border of Monterey County?
I need to ask transportation, our engineering, and we can get that information to you. I think that their bid was somewhere around $20,000 to $30,000 higher than American Construction Engineers. So, but that's just the update. So that we're anxious to get that done. We've been talking about this. We've been talking about this since I started here, so 3 years, and just to get to a point where we got the plans done and then get it out to bid and rebid it. So that's the update on that.
Commissioner Flores, do you have a question on that?
Oh, sorry.
Just to ask, there were no actual bids from the local area at all, from what I understand?
I don't know. I can't recall who the second bidder was. And like I said, we can get that information to you. But just only two bids. That's it.
But are you talking about, Richard, are you talking about the
contractors
sub-trades?
Must be busy.
I'm sorry.
Are you talking about the sub-trades or the general contractor?
The general contractor.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I'll have to follow up with the commission and let you know.
Okay, the last thing is operations and fuel flowage, if you'd walk us through that.
So first thing is the operations report. We're doing better than we were last year. Last year we had 4,185 operations, and this year in February we have 5,343. And I'm sure I'm about 100 of those, so that's good.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's good to hear.
And then the other thing is the fuel flows report. We're doing better than we did last year in 100 low lead and Jet A. And what I wanted to show you specifically with regards to Jet A is that in February, Jet West pumped 54,000 gallons of Jet A as compared to 30,000 the year before. There's a couple things that are in the works. Jet West conveyed to me that they had a few good big fuel sales come in, and then on top of that, Jet West just completed doing upgrades to their fuel system, and they are what was called mil-spec, and they are ATA 103 certified. So the ATA is the Air Transportation Association of America. What this means specifically for mil-spec is that they have won a contract to do military fueling here at the airport. So we should see a significant increase in Jet A sales, our military contract sales at Salinas, because he did the upgrades and they passed their inspection. So we've seen, just even over the last couple months, we've seen a lot more military aircraft coming in, a lot of helicopters that are en route doing training, are stopping by and picking up fuel at the airport. So that is a good thing for the airport. So questions, comments?
Yeah, I noticed that is good. We've had C-130 traffic in here on a regular basis in the old days, so maybe that'll pick up again. Any questions, Commissioner Purvis?
And you said these are fuel sales. I thought they were actually the fuel being brought into the tank.
This is what's transported. So, but fuel sales, yeah, their fuel sales are up. If their fuel sales are up and they're buying fuel, the transport numbers go up. So,
okay, their Jet A, their purchases basically.
Yeah, their purchase.
Thank you.
Okay, that's all the questions on fuel flowage. Then we have announcements. Do we have any announcements?
I have a few announcements. Okay. Just wanted to follow up. If you haven't done your local ethics training, that's due April 1st. Got mine done this last month. You have to do 2 hours of training online. It doesn't matter if you finished the training in 20 minutes. You have to spend 2 hours in front of that computer before you get your certification.
And the system makes you start all over if you happen to go through too fast. And you can actually do it in an hour and a half by being, just if you read it, not speed read it, but just,
yeah. Get your form 700 done. If you haven't done that, mine's done. Just want to remind the commission, we're settling on the date, April 16th, for a public workshop that will be functions of an airport commission. We're getting the outlines done. A few of the things, such as the Brown Act, conflict of interest, ethics, rules of decorum, parliamentary procedure, airport bylaws, regulations, stuff on the enterprise fund. We're working with a consultant. We're going to really break down the aviation industry for you so you can understand how we play a role in the aviation industry. So, comment?
Yeah, because that I completely forgot about and I committed myself to something else on the 16th.
We're actually going to record it, so we'll sit down with you afterwards.
I'll read it for 2 hours.
There's no fast forward on that. And I'll be out of town on the 16th also. That's April 16th, right?
April 16th.
Yeah, I'll be gone. Way gone.
Are you going to be here the 23rd?
No, I'll be gone. I'll be...
I'd have to double check for myself.
Anyone else going to be gone?
I'll be here.
Is there any way that you can choose whether it's April 16th or 23rd? Because
we can push it back.
Oh, darn.
I'm not talking about pushing it back. I just meant, April 16th or 23rd was last month as well.
I didn't update this. Sorry about that. I didn't update the slide. The date that is being more tuned into by our consultant being available was the 16th. But if the commission wants to push it back to where everyone's here, I can tell them that we want to push it back and we'll push it back.
Be more beneficial, wouldn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And I don't know, I'd have to check my calendar. I'll have to double check and let you know. I can send you an email as soon as I get home.
So what I can do is I can email the consultant, see if they have dates after that that they're available. And then and do that. I know May for me is shot. I'm gone, I think, 3 weekends out of May. So that makes it very tough for me to be able to commit anything in May. So.
These dates are on a weekend?
It's a Saturday. And then any other questions on that?
On the Form 700, do you have a way of checking with the city clerk? I did mine online, and it said it. I did it, but I was told that you're supposed to get an email back and then forward that to the city clerk, and I never got an email.
I'll have Chris follow up and check and get back
okay.
with you.
Can you check on mine, too, please? I didn't get an email back.
You didn't either? Okay. Yeah. All right.
Chris will just check to see who's all done and signed off. And then
that might have been wrong information.
The last thing I just want to announce at the last city council meeting this last Tuesday, city council moved to approve the AIP 25 airport electrical and rehabilitation and PMMP project. So this project is moving forward. This was at the last commission, and you guys had moved this forward to city council. So. That's it.
Okay, do we have any general public comments? Seeing none, do we have any future agenda items that anybody wants to put on the agenda that we haven't already discussed? Seeing none, our next meeting date will be April 28th, 2016. I noticed in the bylaws that I'm supposed to announce that when our next meeting is. So April 28th, 2016.
Are you going to be back in town?
I would come back on the 26th.
Okay. She'll be here.
So, yeah.
So April 28th at 6 o'clock.
Great.
Oh, gosh.
No, we haven't made that.
No. It won't be at 6 o'clock.
No,
it'll be at 7
o'clock. April 28th at 7 o'clock.
Oh, okay.
We have to vote on it then.